I'm Stuart McLaurin, president of the White House Historical Association. Today, I have the privilege of talking with the authors of our newest publication, Designing Camelot, the Kennedy White House Restoration and Its Legacy, James Archer Abbott and Elaine Rice Bachman. Jim currently serves as the director of the Lewis Historical Society in Lewis, Delaware, and Elaine is the newly named state archivist at the Maryland State Archives and the secretary of the State House Trust. We've been publishing books since 1962 at the direction of Mrs. Kennedy, our founder. We are in the 60th year of our history, and this extraordinary book is probably the most beautiful on the exterior and substantive on the interior of all the publications that we've done. So congratulations to both of you, and thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I know in authoring this, you feel like you're probably best friends with Mrs. Kennedy, getting to know her so well. So I want to begin by posing to both of you, if you had the opportunity to visit with her over a meal or tea and talk with her, what is something that you would really love to ask her?
Well, it's interesting that you ask that because I was recently reading my prospectus from my graduate school thesis written in 1992, which is when I started working on this. And I very earnestly listed out the personal interviews I planned to get. And one of them was with Miss Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis. And of course, at that time, I did not fully understand the depth of the privacy that she kept, which I really admire. So I often think back, well, had I gotten that interview, what would I have asked? And I imagine it would have just been a sort of fangirl experience where I would be so in awe of what she had done. But I think I would certainly have asked her if she could have imagined the impact that she would have on the White House in her time there.
I would build on that. For my undergraduate thesis at Vassar, I did not communicate with her directly, but she would guide me through her secretary. I would receive these blue letters in my mailbox, and each one would tell me I should contact this person or I should contact that person. But the thing I would love to ask her is, would she see herself as an instigator with regards to educating not just museum curators and connoisseurs, but the general public in an appreciation for history and preservation? Because I don't think that she necessarily entered the White House with that as an intent, but I do think that her legacy is obviously very clear, and it did affect the professional field of museum curators and directors. And then it also, looking at preservation in this country, I can't help but wonder that the Lewis Historical Society, for which I'm the director, I can't help but believe that that institution exists in part because of Mrs. Kennedy's mastery of television and of the written word and of her own passion with regards to history and preservation.
Well, it's interesting that that's what you would like to ask her, because that's what I wanted to ask you. What do you think she would think of it all of these years later, that this had lasted so long, what she began?
You know, I don't think she would be surprised. As much as she came into the White House initially wanting to create a home for her family, I think as her project grew and its influence grew, and certainly the captivation that the national audience had for it, I think she realized how important it was that she put the policies in place that would go beyond her residency there, which of course she imagined to be longer than it was. But she could see beyond that and knew that there took certain protections that needed to be in place for it to last. So I hope that she would be very proud.
I think that one of the things that always stands out is, I think we started this project when we were younger than she was entering the White House, and obviously we're a little older. And we have to keep in mind that Mrs. Kennedy entered the White House with a vision to create a home for her family. And at the same time, she had a great interest in creating a dramatic backdrop for her husband's administration, for his vision for the country. What became the Kennedy Restoration really was part of a tutorial that I think Mrs. Kennedy went through in the 2 years, 10 months, 2 days that she was First Lady. And then it also involved Mrs. Kennedy's own personal passion in history, and I dare say also the president's, because I think they worked as a team. It's easy for us to assume that there have been closer presidential couples in the White House, and my feeling is the exact opposite. I think that the Kennedys, intellectually, they were intertwined. Using history as a tool, I think they were an extremely in-tune pair. So,
and Caroline Kennedy's introduction to the book really speaks to that, which I think is so, so eloquent.
Yeah, we're so honored to have had her done that with us, and it is a wonderful summary of the story. Well, Jim, you mentioned the short period of time that was the Kennedy presidency, less than 3 years. I marvel that when her husband is elected president of the United States in 1960, she's 31 years old. Mm-hmm. What were her inspirations? What was going on in her mind, and what did she come to the White House prepared to do?
She very famously said that when she visited when she was 11, she came away from the house very unimpressed. You know, there wasn't really a sense of history in that place. So she certainly addressed that with the guidebook. But I think she also came to her position very well educated and very interested in history and a voracious reader. And having spent that time in France at the Sorbonne, really admiring the French system of government and the fact that there was a minister of culture and that there was very baked into their government an appreciation for the arts and culture. And she saw that was lacking in Washington and in the American government. And I think as America was entering sort of onto the national stage, she really knew that in order to bring attention to the history of the entirety of the country, she had this stage set within the White House that she could play a part of.
But she also recognized that history had to be reinvented or reconnected with. And I think the White House afforded that opportunity. The idea of bringing the George Catlin paintings of American Indians to the second floor of the White House, that wasn't a fluke. She had admired them as a student of George Washington University. She knew them. And it's intriguing to me, and Elena and I have both discussed this, about thinking about people of color being exhibited in the White House, how she was insistent that this one space that would become the premier processional to the Yellow Oval Room for state dinners, that it be a gallery of Native American Indians. That was really quite innovative, and it emphasized how she saw history serving a function, a purpose, as the nation was moving into a new age.
Well, and something she carried over into all aspects of the White House. I mean, we don't talk about representation as we do today, at that time. But with the Catlin paintings of the Native Americans, with inviting African American performers for the first time into the White House, I mean, she really did look at the big picture of America and how is it represented in this house, both through events and through the works of art that were there. So it's extraordinary.
And not just in the house proper. I believe her sophistication with social diplomacy and soft diplomacy around the world. We were in a somewhat precarious position with France at the time. Her outreach and her relationships with bringing the Mona Lisa over, even though it was not at the White House, but the Americans that were able to see that extraordinary work of art and the diplomacy that was required on her part to navigate and negotiate that demonstrates an extraordinary sophistication for someone as First Lady of the United States. So she brings into the White House this life of preparation, if you will. And how does she select, choose, appoint those who would advise her?
Well, Jim mentioned Jane Reitzman, and we've talked a lot and debated in writing the new edition, how did Mrs. Kennedy get introduced to Henry DuPont? Because there's several people who've claimed it over time, and there probably was a combination of events that occurred. But there's no question that in order for this not to be seen as a First Lady redecorating the White House and to be seen as partisan, they needed to reach out to the decorative arts academia, as it were, at that time. And really, there was only one American who had risen to the top of the American decorative arts field, and that was Henry DuPont. And so in connecting with Mr. DuPont, she really was connecting with the person who had the most gravitas in terms of looking at objects and material culture and furnishings and how they could convey history. And so she was certainly encouraged to create a committee that would be seen as something that would govern this project rather than her just simply redecorating.
President Kennedy was very concerned about this being seen as a political endeavor. And so the Kennedy Restoration called upon Republicans and Democrats to come together, those both passionate about American art, American decorative arts, architecture. It was a unified gathering. And I have to say that in subsequent administrations, although, for instance, you could look at the Nixon administration and this wealth of treasures that is acquired on the threshold of the American Bicentennial, it was a much more political, it was a much more Republican-based endeavor or effort, the Committee for the Preservation of the White House at that time. And it seems that some administrations have made it more political. But to that, Mrs. Kennedy was insistent that it had to be a joint effort between both political factions. the country really was engaged, and it didn't matter your political affiliation.
Well, I will say, I do think it's incredible that what she put in place to fund acquisitions and the restoration and maintain the White House by the creation of the association was an extraordinary foresight that every president and first lady have benefited from. And we're now working with our 12th president and first lady, and our role is essentially the same, regardless of the party or the politics of the president and first lady. And
of course, she was criticized for wanting to sell a guidebook. It was a heavy lift for her to convince the president's advisors that this was not going to be seen as some tacky operation of selling, you know, tchotchkes from the White House. I mean, she really had to stick to her principle that this was an essential part of her project. And of course, it was enormously popular, and tourism nearly tripled at the White House, and everyone bought this guidebook for a dollar.
And her letter of introduction, which I find one of the most charming facets, is initially it was envisioned for children because of how crowded a White House tour could be. And I'm paraphrasing. It's a shame that they would leave the house and not have a memento or not have an opportunity to revisit the history. But as more research was done, she felt that it needed to be a book that was written at a scholarly level. And then with that, she came back to, it's the parent speaking, the mother of John and Caroline coming back and saying, of course, it's not a bad thing for a child to read above their level. So the expectation that a parent would sit down and read about Charles-Henri Lanuet and about Gilbert Stuart, as well as about the presidents, et cetera, but the parents would engage with the children. We saw that. You were part of that. Or we will see that on our trip. It became very much of an investment in American history, which I do think the Kennedy administration was locked into in a variety of ways, not just with this wonderful restoration, but I think in policies as well.
Well, that guidebook was the first publication that we worked on in 1962 at her direction in partnership with National Geographic. In fact, this week we're doing photography at the White House to update the next edition of that, which will be out in the fall. And that really began this wonderful publications business that we're in now, which has led us to designing a Camelot. Speaking of Camelot, what's so magical about that phrase, and how did it attach to them in this period in our nation's history, and what she accomplished with the house?
That is something I think she might be surprised by, how much that anecdote that she dropped into the interview just a few days after her husband died about Camelot and the two of them listening to the soundtrack in the White House. I wonder if she could have imagined how far that would carry into the future. But I do think it's very evocative of a time and a place. Camelot is something beautiful, something sad, and something brief.
And Camelot also has an ideal, and getting back into the politics, and John F. Kennedy, the politician, to inspire, to motivate, to move people forward. Camelot does that. There's a tragedy in the tale, but yet it encourages us to move forward. And I think it's all the more appropriate that it's associated with the Kennedy administration for that reason.
As she undertook this work, what were some of the challenges that she faced in addition to her husband's reluctance and concern about the political optics of it? And were there things that she really wanted to undertake or do that she was unable to do?
I think she was so personally motivated and so capable. I think one of her challenges was simply sitting back and letting someone else do some of the work that she was really so capable of doing herself. So when you read the correspondence and you read the letters back and forth and you read the sort of push and pull of these various decorators who were in the house, you know, ultimately it was her decision about where things would go. But she was really a master of diplomacy.
The idea of the president, and did they ever lock horns over a particular project or facet? I know that the president was at first not convinced that the blue room walls should be white instead of blue. But Mrs. Kennedy won out. But they worked as a team. I really think that they were in this together. In almost every way, he was proud of her, and she was always consulting him at every facet.
And they both acknowledged that there was a great deal of public interest in their project. And to think about challenges, I think a challenge that she faced always was balancing that enormous public appeal, which really benefited her project, with her sense of privacy and not wanting to have that breached.
I do think that Jacqueline Kennedy in 1961 and 1962 was very cautious about using non-American product. But something happened by 1963. And I'm not sure if it's with the televised tour and winning Americans' interest for the project. But by late 1963, just before the assassination, I mean, textiles were being contemplated from Europe. And Mrs. Reitzman was working on negotiating a purchase of an early 19th century dinner service that would then have been expanded to include some modern place settings. I don't think Jacqueline Kennedy could have gotten away with those things in 1961 or 62. But by 1963, I think the whole idea of as long as it's the best. So there was a progression, an evolution.
Well, you mentioned the White House tour. There came that magical moment on Valentine's Day of 1962, when she does take the American public into the house with CBS's Charles Collingwood. Not only did CBS air that program, but ABC and NBC did as well. It was the entire nation. At the end of that program, the president himself comes in and I think gives an extraordinary validation of her work, not just in the design, in the house itself, but what she has established for young people in America to learn about their White House and that American history can be understood and appreciated through all that took place. So his words, when I hear that and see that, I think how proud she must have felt to have received his validation on
that
occasion.
Well, he filmed that twice. He initially was filmed having just come from a long day at the office, sort of knew he had to do this sort of short on-camera 20-second presentation. And when he saw the rushes of that, he knew it did not fit in with the tone she had set during the tour. And he was enormously proud of that. And so he re-recorded that to be the words that we all hear today when we watch that.
Well, given all that she accomplished so quickly and not knowing that the administration would be cut short as tragically as it was, what she put in place really became the foundation for ongoing historic preservation and acquisitions at the White House today. Had that foundation not been put in place, the third presidency after the major Truman restoration and the house was furnished with not the very best of America, what would have happened for those who followed? Would there have been another first lady that would have put that in place? What might the White House look like today had she not done what she did 60 years ago?
I think the nature of scholarship and decorative art scholarship was such that it was moving toward that ultimately. It's the timing of when she made this effort, because mm-hmm. she's certainly not the first lady to want to bring history and beauty
That's
to
true.
The White House. But no one had the capture of the media, the timing that she had, and of course, the broadness of her effort in incorporating mm-hmm. the larger mm-hmm. Fine Arts Committee. And, you know, we haven't mentioned hiring the first curator for
yes,
the White House,
absolutely.
Lorraine Waxman Pierce, who had been a student at Winterthur, specialist in L'Ennuyer and recommended by Mr. DuPont. So establishing just that office, which was then codified during the Johnson administration, really put in motion all that we have today.
I'll add two things. One is that in 1963, before the birth of Patrick in August of 63, Mrs. Kennedy had sent a letter to Paris to the French design firm Janssen, and she asked for two schemes. She wanted a scheme for Caroline's bedroom and a new decorative scheme for John's bedroom, because her concern, as expressed, was, I have no guarantee that the person who succeeds me is going to have an interest in continuing the work. So that was one. She was definitely thinking about a continuation, and this is before the assassination. So she definitely recognized its importance beyond the Kennedy presidency. The second is in looking at the politics of the Kennedy restoration. What became the politics? This became a legacy. The White House became as much a shrine to John F. Kennedy as his gravesite in Arlington, or as the cultural center named the John F. Kennedy Center. That's a really hard thing for a new president to move into.
But what they put in place really did become America's mind standard of what the White House should be. Let's talk a bit about the collection itself. There was no formal collection prior to the Kennedys. There was no curator, someone to actually take care of these art objects and furnishings. Why was that, and how important was her putting that in place?
Well, I think it just reflects what was happening in public houses throughout the country. I have worked with the Governor's Mansion in Maryland for years, and it wasn't until 1969, largely inspired by Mrs. Kennedy's efforts, that an effort was made to create the state's art collection, to really look around and determine what is worthy. she did that for the country. And it really just speaks to the idea of what was happening throughout public residences. And in the White House, because there were so many souvenir hunters over time, there just wasn't a sense of permanency. And of course, the house itself was really only 10 years old, if you will, because of the complete gutting of the building during the Truman administration. And it's always a question of budgets when you're dealing with public houses as well. Every First Lady, you can go back through time, has had that lament as they've moved into that house. How do we furnish it? So there wasn't necessarily a great deal of wonderful objects to make permanent when Mrs. Kennedy moved in. It was through her efforts to uncover things that made it a worthy collection, worthy of permanence. And of course, that's been built on ever since to this day. Mm-hmm.
There has always been a White House collection, but we must remember that for its first century and for a little part into the second century, if the White House wanted to buy a new porcelain service, there had to be so many broken plates. And then the monies that would pay for that new service perhaps would come from the sale of the remaining plates. And the same would be true of chairs and that wonderful suite of Boulanger furniture in the Blue Room. The chairs didn't miraculously disappear per se. It was a concerted effort to enhance the White House through President James Buchanan's administration to make it more regal, in fact, on the threshold of the Civil War. And so the Monroe furniture had to be gotten rid of to be able to buy a grander suite, or what was seen as a grander suite for that Oval Salon. With that said, the White House collection in itself has only become stronger through the White House Historical Association. And I don't think Mrs. Kennedy was thinking about that in 1961, but I do think by 1963, I think she stood back and recognized she had helped to create a protection for anything and everything in the White House at that time and for the future.
I think she definitely knew that each person that came into that house would make it their own. The protections that were put in place were not to create frozen rooms.
And getting back to her evolution as a scholar, connoisseur, and First Lady, in 1961, she wanted only things of the 19th century. By 1963, she's writing to Mr. DuPont to preserve a mantelpiece that had been built in the White House carpentry shop for the Queen's bedroom. She was evolving, and she had taken on 20th century objects as having as great of importance than those early 19th century French things that we associated her with. And I think that's really important, because if the Kennedy administration had continued, it would be fascinating to think about, would all of Penn Station have been lost in New York? Or perhaps there would have been a more sensitive curating of carved stonework and of facets of that great edifice, and a greater appreciation if she had been the First Lady for another 4 years. I remember interviewing Jim Ketchum, so the third curator of the White House, the last one appointed by Mrs. Kennedy, during my research for an undergraduate thesis, and I remember asking him, what would be the difference between the Kennedy restoration in your eyes and subsequent efforts? And he said, well, later efforts have really focused on period rooms, on set periods. And he said he felt that Mrs. Kennedy, then Mrs. Onassis, would have encouraged something owned by Jimmy Carter being included in a stateroom, of having a greater continuum.
Perhaps had that presidency not ended so tragically, she would have felt more comfortable staying connected to the White House and to First Ladies that followed, and had a little bit different relationship with them as well, which would have been interesting to see.
But she did have every one of your books.
She did.
She did, and many copies. She was proud of this restoration project, and I think she'd never cut herself off from it. It remained with her to the end.
That's wonderful to think about. I do want to touch on our operational headquarters is in historic Decatur House on the northwest corner of Lafayette Park. And in thinking about her influences beyond the White House itself, the work that she did to save Lafayette Park from what it could have been, which would have been horrific had that taken place. Tell us a little about that story.
Absolutely. I mean, she really took the enormous public appeal that she had for her efforts in the White House that built her confidence in stepping beyond the walls of the White House, really into Washington itself. And of course, what became the Kennedy Center was already underway and planning too, but right across the street there at Lafayette Square. I mean, she became aware that the demolition of those townhouses was already scheduled. I mean, it was a fait accompli. And she took such an enormous interest in the preservation of that and the preservation of that view from the White House, that it was really her influence that enabled that project to be turned around.
We look at Lafayette Square as this charming square with 19th century houses, but many of them are actually 1960s, 1970s
right.
constructions.
Right.
That serve government offices, government workers. And then you have these towers designed by John Carl Warnecke that grow from within. It's a beautiful composition, and it is a landmark national example in appreciating the past while moving forward. So I think she would feel very pleased if she were here today looking out at Lafayette Park, Lafayette Square, and seeing how that's matured. It really looks like it's always been there.
Rather than thinking that the White House as we know it began with President and Mrs. Kennedy, let's look at former iterations of work in the White House and caring for its appearance and being a ceremonial stage and a home for the president. Who would be some of the more significant influences as a First Lady?
Well, I think starting out, it's interesting that in the early 19th century, the White House taste was really dictated by the 18th century gentleman. So in that first quarter of the 19th century, I think you're safe in saying that the White House was defined by the male aesthetic. And it's only in mid-19th century to the late 19th century that we start to see the influence, the actions of a First Lady taking place. But I think probably the one who is most influential or was most influential is sort of the unsung hero. It's Lew Henry Hoover, who brought in a researcher for the surviving objects in the White House, to identify them, to photograph them, to actually establish the first curatorial-based record of artifacts in the White House. But I do believe that Jacqueline Kennedy's initial efforts took advantage of all of that material that had been put in place by Lew Henry Hoover.
You both worked on this project initially in the late 1990s in the first edition of this book, and we're so honored and excited to have this edition that's out now and available through our website, whitehousehistory.org. But as you undertook this edition of the book, in closing, I'd like for each of you to share something that you learned about Mrs. Kennedy that you didn't learn or appreciate fully the first time around, but that really came home to you in the work that you did for this book.
I think she was an astute politician and statesperson in her own right. She had an agenda, and it was not self-serving. It was to the benefit of the nation. And that becomes all the more clear going into the first edition, and then as we've worked on this, just seeing how strategic she was and calculating in a nice way of getting donors, brilliant marketing, brilliant salesmanship, and all for the benefit of the country.
I completely agree with everything that Jim said. She was a brilliant diplomat, and she certainly was wielding a lot of different personalities. But I'm also really struck by her kindness throughout this and the beautiful sense of manners, which of course she was brought up with. She was brought up in this social world, but she was so kind in always reaching out to Mr. DuPont and his wife and inviting them to events. And as I've gone back and looked at the photographs of the various state dinners and events that they attended, she always placed Mr. DuPont at the table with her. And he was not a great conversationalist, I don't believe. In fact, he was somewhat hard of hearing. And I thought, what a kindness. So I think in addition to all the power that she wielded and all the different machinations that it took for her to make this success a project, at heart, you know, I think she appreciated the time that people were devoting to this project on her behalf and that she was getting so much of the credit for. She was always a master at writing thank you notes and acknowledging the appreciation she had for the time and expertise of people that were a part of this project.
Well, thank you both for this book and for telling the story, enhancing the story that you first began many years ago. And this is a wonderful treasure, and we look forward to doing other events with you to promote Designing Camelot, the Kennedy White House Restoration, and its legacy. Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Stuart.